Okay.
In this series of video lectures, we're going to go ahead and talk about what are called public goods and common goods. And let's first start with a distinction between goods that are what we call rival versus non-rival. So rival goods are goods where people are rivals for the use or consumption of that good. So if I'm eating a ham sandwich, you can't also eat it. And if I'm driving my car north, you can't drive my car south. Some goods, though, are what we call non-rival, that one person's use or enjoyment of the good doesn't impair other people's use or enjoyment of the good. And one way of thinking about this is to look at the idea of the marginal cost per user. If we say that a good is non-rival, what we're saying is that the marginal cost per user is basically zero, or pretty close to it. If we're saying that the good is rival, we're saying that the marginal cost is significantly above zero. So really, there's a kind of continuum here between goods that are like totally non-rival because they have marginal cost of zero, goods where there's a very small amount of rivalry, where the marginal cost is near zero but not completely zero, to goods where almost all the cost is marginal cost. So that's one distinction we want to look at. The other distinction we want to look at is whether or not a good is excludable or non-excludable. So, for an excludable good, it is both physically feasible or technologically feasible and legally permissible to exclude people from using it. And in particular, to exclude people from using it if they don't pay. For a non-excludable good, it's either sort of technologically non-feasible or legally impermissible, it's not allowed, to exclude people from using it who don't pay. And if you put these two different characteristics together, you can construct a little matrix, and we can think of goods where people are rival and goods where they're non-rival. And again, think about this as a continuum. Essentially, we're measuring marginal cost per user as we go up here. Marginal cost per user of zero would put us down here. Really high marginal cost per user would put us up there. And then we can look at the excludability issue. Either the good is excludable or it's non-excludable. And we're not going to worry about this continuousness for now. We're just going to go, it's either rival or non-rival. Likewise, we're not going to worry, well, it could be really, really excludable, or kind of semi-maybe excludable, or totally non-excludable. We're just going to call it black and white, zero and one here. So, goods which are rival and excludable are most of our normal goods that we think about. So, things like food, things like a doctor's appointment. You know, if I'm seeing the doctor right now, you can't see the doctor, or at least, you know, it would be hard for the doctor to serve us both equally well. And obviously, you can be excluded. The doctor doesn't have to see you. at least if you're talking outpatient clinic, if we were talking an emergency room, maybe the doctor does have to see you. Maybe they're not legally allowed to turn people away from the emergency room. So we could say that, say, for instance, a clinic visit, that's really small, clinic, in the doctor's office would be there. The doctor in the emergency room could be over here. Because one more person coming into the emergency room puts a burden on the system, it consumes real resources, but we're not legally or morally allowed to turn people away from the emergency room who need emergency room medical care. We could go ahead and look at something that is non-rival and excludable, and this would be a situation of many types of intellectual property intensive goods. So something like a movie or a song or something like that would be non-rival because the marginal cost per user is basically zero, but excludable because people have intellectual property rights. If we had intellectual assets that there were no property rights on, something very general like the germ theory of disease or the laws of gravitation or something like that. You can't patent stuff like that. So non-protected intellectual content would go down in this corner. This corner up here we call private goods, and everything we've done so far in economics, we've been mainly thinking about private goods. Down here, this goes by a couple of different names. A common one is what's called a club good. So the idea here is you think about, you know, some fancy club or country club or something, and they've got a swimming pool. Well, the fact that they have gates on the place mean that it's excludable, but, you know, maybe adding one more person to the swimming pool doesn't make anyone worse off, so it's non-rival. Over here, we have what's called a public good. And then finally, up in this corner, we have what's called a common good. And, you know, it's kind of unfortunate that club good, public good, and common good maybe all sound very similar. In particular, public goods and common goods sound very similar. But those are the names that the economics profession has decided upon, so we're kind of stuck with those. Okay, so we know that markets provide private goods. And we know that markets provide club goods. They may lead to natural monopoly, because you can see where if the marginal cost per user is zero and there's a fixed cost, then there's going to be economies of scale. So it could be a natural monopoly. If the entry of new competitors is difficult and if there are a few close available substitutes, but it could also be something like oligopoly or monopolistic competition. So the point, though, is that either with greater or lesser efficiency, depending upon the fixed costs to start up a competition or the other barriers to entry out there, or the difficulty of making substitute goods, markets will provide this pretty efficiently in the case of monopolistic competition, less efficiently in the case of natural monopoly. These other two goods over here, though, where we have non-excludability come into play, that gets trickier. Because if you can't exclude someone who doesn't pay, then how are you going to make money off providing this good? And that's something that we'll go ahead and look into in a bit.